So let's start our evening with prayer, as we should always start everything we do. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, look down upon us and bless us this evening as we talk and explain and explore the incredible facts of Our Lady Guadalupe and her apparitions to Juan Diego. We ask that you open our hearts and our minds to hear the way you would have us hear, that I may speak the way you would have me speak, so that we can all get an increased understanding of Our Lady and how it can help grow our spirituality and our love for the Church. We ask this through of you, Father, through your Son, Jesus, through the intercession of Our Lady of Guadalupe and Saint Juan Diego. Amen. In the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So we're here to talk to you about Our Lady of Guadalupe. Now, what I want to do, because it's easier, I think, to see on this slide, is show you a couple of things that just whet your appetite. This is the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And right over here, right across her arm, do you see this right here? Take a look at that. Don't look too deeply, but just take a look at that and tell me what you think that looks like right there. What I heard it over here. A crucifix. A crucifix. Now look on her arm. See, this is the up and down. This is the going across. Jesus' head. This is his wrap around his waist and his knees coming down. So already an image of the crucifixion on the image of Our Lady Guadalupe. Now, in the time when she appeared, they didn't have a written language. They didn't use letters. They had what they called codices or a codex. Everything was done in pictures. So it's kind of like what you might know of the Chinese or the Japanese. All those little figures are actually pictures, right? Or hieroglyphics in Egypt. These were pictures that they would communicate with. And this image of Our Lady, miraculously given to us by her, is a collection of pictures so that when they saw it, they immediately understood. And I'll share with you some, but not all, of those things that are on her image. But I'm really going to talk to you about this story, a man, a woman, and a flower. Of course, the woman is Our Lady Guadalupe, and the man is Saint Juan Diego, and the flower is the Castilian rose. Let me give you a summary of what we're going to do. We're going to do this little history of Mexico, talk about the Aztecs and Cortez, a Spanish conquistador that came to the New World. We're going to talk about the apparitions of Our Lady with Juan Diego and Juan Bernardino, the image of Our Lady, because it's very scientific. It's been studied now for almost 500 years, and no one can explain it. And of course, the miracles that have been associated with this image. So it started back in the first century, 40 AD. Saint James the Apostle, Saint James the Greater, who was the older brother of John, right? James and John, you always hear it together. Peter and Andrew, James and John. No, James and John were brothers. They were fishermen like Peter and Andrew. Well, James the Greater went to Spain, and sometimes you hear about the way. The Santiago de Compostela, which is where his body is a city in Spain, and the Camino de Santiago are all the roads that he traveled trying to convert the people of the Iberian Peninsula to Christianity. And in the year 40, he was in a town called Saragossa, named after Augustus Caesar. We call it Saragossa today. It was actually Caesar Augustus. While he was there, he was doubting his ability to succeed. And Mary appeared to him. Two angels brought Mary to him and put a pillar in the ground and stood Mary on the pillar. She was carrying a statue of herself with the child Jesus in her arms on the statue. And she said to James, James, don't worry. Probably called him Jimmy, you think? Jimmy, don't worry. These people will do great things for my son. The pillar went right into the earth. Do you know that they can't find the bottom of it? The angels put it there and they can't find the bottom. It's amazing. You can go and see that pillar today and they have a place where you can touch it and kiss it. Well, she stood on this pillar and she said that to St. James. These people will do great things for my son. Then in the early or late 13th century, I believe it was, when the Moors had invaded Europe and they were taken over Spain, there were lots of battles. The armies always had images of Our Lady. An image given to the Bishop of Seville that was carved by St. Luke, right, as a gift, was in jeopardy of being lost if the Moors, if the Muslims took over, because they desecrated everything that was Catholic at the time. They would burn the churches, they would ruin the statues. So they buried it with all of the documentation about what it was and where it was and how it got there. And now, many years later, 600 years later, in this 12th century or 13th century, a farmer by the name of Gil Cordero was beginning to get apparitions of Mary. And in one of these apparitions, she said, go and get the priests and dig right here on this site. And so they did. And eventually they unearthed this statue and everything about it. So they built a chapel and they called it, because of the nearby river, the Shrine of Our Lady of Guadalupe. Now it's not the same Our Lady of Guadalupe as we know, but it was Our Lady of Guadalupe in Extremadura, Spain. This became a very famous place. The king and queen of Spain, when Ferdinand II married Isabella I, they united the Aragon with the Castilian and they created Spain, what we now know as the country of Spain. And they were the first time a king and queen had exactly the same powers. The king wasn't any more important or didn't have any more power than the queen. They were a good Catholic family. A good Catholic marriage, and they shared everything equally. And they're the ones that would go to this shrine as well. Generals, navigators, Christopher Columbus, they would all go to this shrine in the late 1400s. In 1486, Christopher Columbus met the king and queen and said, I have this plan to go to India, but I'm not going to go the land route. I'm going to go the sea route. I'm going to go west and travel all the way around to come to India. Why was he going to do that? A lot of people think it was because he was in search of new trade, if he wanted to get more land. No. Christopher Columbus was a Third Order Franciscan. And after reading Isaiah, he felt he was called to go and convert souls, to go to the ends of the earth. And he knew that at one time when they first started introduced Christianity to India, they had asked the Pope to send missionaries to help, and the Pope was never able to do that. So he wanted to complete that. So he goes and he tells King and Queen of Spain about it, and they said, yes, but we have to wait until the end of the war with the Muslims. So in 1492, on January 2nd, they drove the Muslims out of Spain at the Battle of Granada, and they went to Our Lady of Guadalupe and signed the documentation authorizing Columbus to take this trip. And you can go online and see Christopher Columbus's journal. And it talks, you can actually find the document where it says why he's going on the mission and how much money was being given to him by the King and Queen of Spain. So then he went and he started to get ready. And he got his three best ships. They actually, again, they signed those documents at Our Lady of Guadalupe. Now, what were the names of the three ships? Mayflower? No. The three ships that came to the New World. The Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria. Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria. Who speaks Spanish? What is Nina? Okay, girl. Pinta paints. Santa Maria, Holy Mary. the girl and Our Lady appeared as a 15-year-old girl, paints Holy Mary. What did she do? She left us an image of herself, what for many years people thought might be a painting. It was a prophecy as a part of Columbus's voyage that Our Lady was going to come to the New World. Now, he knew that he needed to have certain winds to make the trip. So he goes off on the September the 6th. He sets away from the port outside the coast of Spain in the Canary Islands. And he's in the bay getting ready to go. He's already left port, but he's sitting there because the winds weren't right. He needed the winds to get him going, the winds to start driving him. And the winds came on September 8th. September 8th is the birthday of Mary. So now he starts to travel across the ocean. And while he's traveling, every night they would sing the Salve Regina on the boat. Every night, all the crew members would come up on deck and they would sing the Salve Regina. And they sighted land on October 11th. Now, what we know today is January 1st is the feast of the Motherhood of Mary, right? The Theotokos, Motherhood of Mary, on January 1st. That used to be the Feast of the Circumcision. And it was in 1969, I believe, when they changed that and brought the Feast of Our Lady, Mother of God, to January 1st. It used to be on October 11th. So they sighted land. They left on her birthday. They sighted land on October 11th, which was the Feast of the Motherhood of God, Feast of Mary's Motherhood, and they landed on October 12th. What was October 12th? The Feast of Our Lady of the Pillar. These aren't coincidences. So it started with Our Lady of the Pillar back in 40, and it culminated on the voyage of Our Lady of the Pillar when Columbus came to the New World. This is what is now Mexico City. It was an island, and these people, the Aztecs, used to live somewhere else, and they were told they had to leave because they had utilized all of the resources. And in their travels, they had a legend that they would find their home when they saw a bush, an eagle sitting on the bush, and it would have in its beak, in its claw, it would have a snake, a serpent. And when they saw that, they should stop. And when they approached this area, this little island, it wasn't quite this big, it was smaller than this when they first got there, they saw a bush with an eagle. An eagle had a serpent in its claw and its beak. That symbol is still on the flag of Mexico, when you see the flag of Mexico. That's what made them settle there. And they took rocks from this volcano in the back, and they kept expanding the island. There were over 20 to 30 million people who lived in that area. 300,000 lived on this island. It had three causeways. The northern part was a freshwater lake, and the southern part was a saltwater lake. And they used to be mixed, but they devised a way to separate them so that they would always have clean water. And that's where the Aztecs settled. They had a funny religion. Their sun was the god, and the moon was a god. And they felt that in order for life to continue, they needed to feed that god because the god would get weak. They had a calendar, and the calendar was very, very good calendar, but it only lasted 58 years. And they thought the calendar would, the world would end at the end of the 58 years unless the gods were happy. And so when it got dark, or when things grew, the crops weren't growing because they didn't get enough sun, they increased the number of human sacrifices. They used to capture people, and they would fatten them up. And then they would bring them up onto their pyramids, and they would cut them open and take their heart out while they were still alive and kill them, and then distribute their bodies to people so that they could eat. They were cannibalistic. And this culture served this Huitzilopochtli, lover of hearts and drinker of blood, and Tezcatlipoca, the tempter at the shoulder, the smoking mirror, the lord of darkness. That sounds an awful lot like the devil to me. And that was the culture that they had. They had symbols with a feathered serpent, and Tlacalel was their chief priest. And they would sacrifice 50,000 people per year. Interestingly enough, that's about the number of abortions we do in the United States these days. And they called it the culture of death because of all those sacrifices, as we call abortions the culture of death today, 500 years later. Well, in 1487, they dedicated the new temples that you see right in the center here. This area right here are temples. And they dedicated these new temples, and in 4 days, 24 hours a day, every 15 seconds, someone was sacrificed. 80,000 people in 4 days. That was the culture that existed just prior to Our Lady of Guadalupe's appearance and prior to Cortez, the conquistador from Spain, just prior to his arrival. There was a priest called Quetzalcoatl, very powerful god. But then there was a priest that had the same name, Quetzalcoatl, and he said the true God was good, but he was banished. But there was a legend, because of his name, since their calendar was so precise, they could translate his name into a day. And it said that he would come back and that he would conquer the Aztecs and reclaim the empire for himself. And the day was going to be April 22nd, 1519. April 22nd, 1519. Montezuma, who was the emperor, died. His son, Montezuma II, takes over. His sister had a dream. And in the dream, she said, I saw these canoes. They were really big canoes. Never seen them so big before, ever. And they had this tree in the middle of it that had this big white cloth, right? A sail. They were sailboats she was dreaming of, but she didn't know what they were. And they had this image on it. They had this emblem, which turned out to be the cross. And they were going to come and they were going to conquer the Aztec people. Cortez, a conquistador, very religious, lands in the area on the shores of Mexico on April 22nd, 1519. It happens to be Good Friday, so he wears his black armor, and he looks just like a priest. So right away, they think it's Quetzalcoatl, and they go back and they tell Montezuma. Well, there were a lot of battles, and it took a couple of years, but in 1521, Cortez, who was fed up with all of the human sacrifice, conquers the Aztecs. And they bring in Franciscans to evangelize the Indians. But even while the Franciscans were evangelizing them, as difficult as it was, there was still some human sacrifice. Bishop Zumarraga was the prior. He was appointed the bishop. Princess Papinson, who was a translator for Cortez, was baptized. And Juan Diego and Maria, his wife, were baptized and got married. They used to walk 15 miles to go to religious ed. They didn't get dropped off like you guys. 15 miles every Saturday they would walk, go to mass, go to religious education, and then 15 miles walk back home. But she got sick and died, and he went to live with his uncle Juan Bernardino, who was only 8 or 9 miles away. So this is what led up to the apparition. So now it's December 9th, which at that time was the feast of the Immaculate Conception. You know, the Gregorian calendar changed it to the 8th, but it used to be the 9th. So it's the feast of the Immaculate Conception. He's walking to go to church and to his education, his religious education, and he hears this beautiful music. And he sees this hill that is like, this hill is nothing but dirt and cactus and stones. But it's beautiful. It's all green and lush. And the birds are singing. And then the birds stop singing. And he's startled. And he hears Juanito, which is like Johnny. Good translation of Juanito is Johnny. Johnny, Johnny, come here, Johnny Diego. And he comes up the hill. And there is a vision of the Blessed Mother. He doesn't know it's the Blessed Mother. He just sees this beautiful woman. She's standing on the moon. She's blocking out the sun. And she says to him, "Know for certain, least of my sons, that I am the perfect and perpetual Virgin Mary, Mother of the true God, through whom everything lives, the Lord of all things near and far, the Master of heaven and earth. It's my earnest wish that a temple or church be put here in my honor, where I will demonstrate, I will exhibit, I will give all my love and my compassion, my help and my protection to the people." Now the people were having trouble because of the Spanish lords that came over after the conquistadors, right? The guys that are in battle, they weren't nearly as bad as the ones that came over as governors. And the priests were trying to keep the peace and they were very worried, but it was very difficult. Well, she's now offering her help and she appears to Juan Diego. She says, "Go to the bishop and tell him this." Young girl, beautiful lady, queen, I'm a nobody. He's not going to listen to me. Find somebody of importance to do this. And she said, "No, my son, it must be you. You are the one that I must have do this." So he agrees. He goes to the bishop. When he gets to the bishop, he waits for a long time. They don't want him to see the bishop. But the bishop is very gracious. So eventually he's patient, he's humble, and he waits and he gets to see the bishop. And when he visits the bishop, he tells the bishop the story. And the story is very hard for the bishop to believe, but he's very gentle and loving, kind of like what you think of with Pope Francis. It's just that, you know, he puts himself in the place of the person telling that story in Juan Diego, and he says, "Thank you, my son. Thank you for that information. Thank you for that message." So he leaves very dejected. Yeah, he was nice. He was pleasant. He listened very intently, but he didn't believe me. So he goes back. The second apparition is on his way home that night, the 9th of December. He goes to Mary and says, "I told him, but he doesn't believe me." And she says, "Not good enough. Go back tomorrow. Tell him again." "Mary, please." Not Mary. He didn't say Mary, but he said, "Please, my lady, most beautiful lady." It's beautiful words. You look it up, you can read them. It's just gorgeous, the dialogue that they had between each other. It's poetry, very, very wonderful. He says, "I can't do this. I'm not worthy. I'm not important enough." And she says, "Know that I have many angels and messengers and leagues of messengers that I can send on this journey, but I don't want them, I want you. Go back tomorrow and tell him again." So he comes back the next day and he goes right to the bishop and he waits and he gets a lot of trouble. They don't want him, they're making fun of him at the gate. They don't want him in, let him in, but he waits and he finally gets to see the bishop and he tells the bishop the same story. You know, and it's like CSI or one of these, you know, TV shows. He said everything exactly the same. He didn't change his story. He must be telling the truth, or at least he thinks he's telling the truth. So the bishop says to him, "Okay, I can't just go and build a church because somebody tells me they saw the Mother of God. But tell her, she'll understand. Give me a sign. Give me a sign that helped me believe, and I will do what she asks." So now he's excited. So he goes back to the hill, Tepeyac Hill. It's now the 10th, right? So this is the third apparition. He goes back to the hill and he tells her what the bishop said, and she says, "Okay, come back tomorrow morning. Come back on the 11th and you'll have your sign." So he goes home, and when he gets home, his uncle, Bernardino, is deathly ill. He's sick. He's so sick. All night long, he's sick, and he stays by his side. He's by his side the whole next day. He forgets all about what he was supposed to do because his uncle, who raised him, it's like his father, is sick and dying. So he stays with him. And then the uncle says, I'm not going to make it. Go and get a priest. I want last rites. I want to receive the Eucharist before I die. Go and get a priest. So he leaves in the morning and he rushes. And when he gets to the hill, he thinks, ah, I was supposed to be here. She's going to be so upset. I'll go around the other side. So he goes around the back of the hill. And of course, Mary intercepts him, comes down the hill and says, Juanito, where are you going? Oh, dear lady, I didn't forget, I did forget. I'm sorry, I don't know what to, my uncle is dying, please, please. And she says to him, Juanito, am I not your mother? Do I not hold you in the crook of my arm? Am I not here for you who am your mother? Your uncle, as we speak, is healed. Go do what I ask. Go up to the top of the hill and you'll find flowers. Cut the flowers and bring them to me. And so he believes her that his uncle is healed. He goes up the hill and on his way up, he's thinking, it's December. We had a frost. There is no way there's flowers up there. But she tells me to do it, I'm going to do it. I'm obedient and I'm humble. And when he gets to the top, as what happens often when you're obedient and humble and dealing with the Lord and his mother, there is everything that she said. And because it was cold, he had gotten a garment. It's called an ayate. You'll hear it all the time as tilma. It's really not exactly accurate. A tilma is made out of cotton, and it was for nobility. The ayate is made out of the fibers of a cactus plant. So imagine getting a spaghetti squash and getting all those fibers and making a jacket, right? Not going to last very long. Well, these were very strong fibers, so they typically last 25 to 30 years, 20, 25 years probably, if they're taken care of. But that's what he had, and it was longer than, he was 6 foot, but it was bigger than him because he would tie it up around his neck. And they would use it to sleep on, he would use it to carry things. So he gets all the flowers and he puts them in the ayate, in the tilma. And he brings them down to Mary. And she takes them and she places them in a particular way inside his ayate. Closes it up and says, bring this to the bishop and do not let anybody see it until you get there. So now he goes to the bishop. And he gets there and they're laughing at him still. Get out of here, you idiot. You're a nobody. Go away. Calling him names, teasing him. He says, no, I have to see the bishop. And while they're giving him a hard time, they see a flower coming out the side of his ayate. And he says, where did he get these flowers from? They went to go reach for it, and it disappeared. And when they pulled their hand back, it reappeared. So they're saying, we better go get the bishop. So they tell the bishop and they take him in there. And he goes in and he tells the bishop the story. Now he's standing in front of the bishop. And he's got this ayate with all these roses in it. And he's telling the bishop and he's looking at him right in the eyes. And that when at the end of his story, he says, please, do me the favor of accepting this gift. The sign that you asked for. And he opens up his ayate. And all of the flowers fall to the ground. And he's like, okay, they fell to the ground, but why isn't he looking at them? Why did his eyes not follow them down to the ground? The bishop kept looking at him. So when he looked down, he could see the image of the woman who appeared to him on his ayate. The bishop fell to his knees, prayed, actually put up the image, and they started to venerate it. They then went and said, that was the fourth apparition, right, when he got the flowers. Then they said, go and get, he told him about his uncle. He said, go take these two men and go and get your uncle and come back here. So they went and got Juan Bernardino and brought him back. And Juan Bernardino told him the story. This woman appeared to me. What time? When was it? And they found out it was exactly the time when Mary said, your uncle is healed. She came to me. She healed me. And she said her name was Our Lady of Guadalupe. And in Nahuatl, which was their language, she spoke to them in their language, Nahuatl. It's Guadalupe, is the translation of Guadalupe, which also means the person who steps on the head of the serpent, just as is in Genesis, right? The person who steps on the head of the serpent. So, they see that, they understand, they start to build a chapel. 2 weeks later, they have the chapel built. These are the roses. They're called Castilian roses. Why was it important? Because it was winter? Well, that was one reason. Roses growing on a hill in winter that doesn't grow anything even in the summer. But they're also roses that only grow in Castile, Spain. And they were the favorite rose of Bishop Zumárraga. And he knows they don't exist in the New World. And here they are on the floor of his parlor as the sign that he asked for. This is a painting of that scene. We know that painting is not correct, which we'll share with you later why we know that. And this is an image that was created of Our Lady curing Juan Bernardino. They built a chapel in 2 weeks, and on the 26th, 14 days later, had a celebration. And when they were celebrating, everybody was singing and dancing and parading. And they were dancing, and the people, you know how sometimes you see in the movies, people get excited, they're shooting their guns, bang, 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 bang. Well, they didn't have guns, they had bows and arrows, so they're shooting bows and arrows in the air, and unfortunately an arrow comes down and it goes right through the neck of a dancer. Kills him instantly. Celebration stops, they pick up the dancer, they bring him to the bishop who is standing right next to the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And he comes back to life before everybody. So now if there was any doubt, they believed. But they were excited because they knew what this woman said when they saw the image, and we'll share that with you. So in the first year, they had 400,000 baptisms. That's over 1,000 a day. 1,000 a day. 12 Franciscans. In the next 10 years, probably less than 10 years, 9 million baptisms. Never before, never since, has an area so totally converted to Christianity and so quickly. You know, just like Peter was sent to Rome to evangelize Christ's life, death, resurrection, and the Eucharist. They weren't around anymore, the apostles. God sent Mary to the New World. Tenochtitlan, or Mexico City, was the largest city in the New World. It was like Rome to the New World. And he sent her there to evangelize. And so did she evangelize, and very well, 9 million in 10 years. This is during the time of the Protestant Reformation. I like to call it revolution, because nothing was really reformed. So it was a revolt. And we lost a little over 5 million Catholics to Protestantism in Europe, but we gained 9 million in the New World in those same 10 years. Within 50 years, 100% of Mexico was converted, 100%. This is the Basilica in Mexico City that now houses the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And this is the image. And it's very beautiful. And everyone that goes says, it's a living image. It speaks to you. You can sense it. It's such peace. And when you gaze your eyes on it, it moves you. And people standing next to each other say totally different things. I say, isn't that the most beautiful blue? It's not blue, it's green. Well, I see blue. Well, I see green. It touches everybody differently, and it's wonderful. I'll use this picture right here. You see this in the bottom, right above the angel? There's an angel, which, by the way, no one has mentioned in any of the readings that I've said. I personally think there's a significance about the third evangelization that will become known as more and more study is done. But that angel has wings, And what are the color of those wings?
Red and white.
Red, white, and blue. What else is red, white, and blue? The flag of the United States. I think we have a very important part to play in the third evangelization, and it's going to come to pass as a result of Our Lady of Guadalupe, who is the star of the new evangelization. So right above that angel, which, by the way, is an angel that has the body of an adult, the body of a child, but the face of an adult, what did they learn when they saw that, knowing everything was in codex? What they learned was that you, even as an adult, you have to come to Mary and to Jesus as a child, just like from the gospel. Don't chase the children away. Everyone must come to me as a child. As a child comes to their father, right? As a child comes to their brother, adopted brother. We're adopted sons of God in Jesus. So right above him is this image right here. See that? Anybody know anything about American history? The Indians? Why, we call them Indians, but the indigenous, the American natives? How did they used to carry their children? On their back. And what do they call that? You remember what they called that? In a papoose, right? Doesn't that look like it's a papoose, but upside down? See the baby's face over here? And it's wrapped in this papoose, but it's face down. When they saw that, they said, oh my goodness, you don't put a baby face down when it's wrapped like that. We're living in a culture of death. Mary blocks out the sun. She's more powerful than the sun. She's standing on the moon, and in fact, it's like more of an eclipse of the moon, which means she's not only more powerful than the moon, but since the moon is the house of their gods, she's actually living there as a god, is what they thought, but till they got better learning later, that she's not really God, but the mother of God. But she lives with the gods. And that's the truth. So, but she's not the most powerful because her head is down in humility, which means there's someone more powerful than she is. Now, in their culture, when you were single, when you were still pre-married, you're still a virgin, the women used to wear their hair very straight, combed out perfectly, straight, very combed, very nice. When you got married, people would know you were married because you braided your hair. You put some of your hair in braids or all your hair in braids. Well, she's got her hair straight, which means she's a virgin. But she's wearing a black sash, which means she's pregnant. That's what they did when you were pregnant. You'd wear a black sash. So they immediately, by seeing this image, knew that she was a virgin mother. They didn't say, oh, they must be wrong. She shouldn't be wearing that sash. No, they knew already that she was something very important and very truthful. So they knew she was the virgin mother. And just below the sash, on her womb, there's a four-petaled flower, which is oriented like an X, which is their sign for divinity. So they knew she was carrying God in her womb. This is the main basilica, and you can see the images here. You can tell how big that basilica is, right? Because that image is more than 6 foot tall with the frame and everything. So you actually get on like a horizontal escalator, you know, a people mover. So you don't have to walk, you can just kind of look at her. John Paul II loved Our Lady of Guadalupe. He was the first pope to visit the shrine of Our Lady of Guadalupe, which is the most visited shrine in all the world. Over 25 million people a year visit. You hear about these places that they boast, oh man, we had 6 million visitors this year. 25 million a year, more than. She's known all over. People love her in the Philippines. They love her in Russia. They love her in Ukraine. They love her, of course, in South America. They love her in the United States and in Canada. The furthest most parish in Alaska, north, the furthest north in Alaska is the parish of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And the parish in the southern tip of Argentina is the parish of St. Juan Diego. That's kind of interesting, isn't it? Where she appeared in Tepeyac? It's the exact geographic center of the Americas. Not close, the exact scientifically determined geographic center of the whole Americas, from the northern part of Canada all the way down to the southern part of Argentina. So the Pope really loved her, and she loved him. And I show this picture because it's a beautiful statue outside the cathedral in Mexico City. And you can see Mary, Our Lady of Guadalupe, right in the heart of John Paul II. And one of the distinctive features of John Paul II is this cross. It was the first time that we've really seen anyone in an iconic way that had that figure of the cross, that curved top, and it's kind of rugged looking. I say that because I was told by a priest who was a regular on EWTN, he was at a conference and he was told that there was an image of John Paul II on the ayate of Our Lady of Guadalupe. Now, John Paul II didn't become Pope until 1979. How could he be on the ayate of Juan Diego from 1531? But he is. And right below her heart, you can almost see right here this curved black line and this straight line here, that's the cross, and this white here is his arms reaching up to hold the cross, his head behind his arms, his body, his waist, and then he's kneeling. Here's his feet, he's kneeling, holding the cross, looking up at this crucifix here as well. That hasn't been confirmed by anybody. Personal belief, I think, from looking at that and hearing what I heard. This is the Church of Santiago in Mexico. What you see that's flat there, that used to be a pyramid where they did sacrifices. And the Franciscans dismantled the pyramid and made a church because the people knew those stones were sacred. Those are the stones that built their temple, which they believed. It wasn't their fault. We know this is incorrect because in technology today, we have determined using all kinds of digital imagery and super microscopes that there were 13 or 14 people in the room with them. How do we know that? Because we were able to make her eyes using a microscope big enough to see the reflection of the people in the room. What? In the image? Yes, in the image. Not only that, but when your eyes see something, it's actually seeing two different things because it's looking at it from different perspectives and your brain processes the one image. So when they look at it, just like a human eye, all of the images are over here, but in this eye, all the images are in the same general place, but different sizes, which is how your eye would see it. So the image itself acts just like human eyes. So much so that when they take the image and they shine a light on the eye in the image, the pupil closes, just like yours. And when they remove the light, the pupil opens, just like yours. What's the temperature of the image? 98.6 degrees. Well, you could ask anybody here, Nathan, what do we keep the church at? About 72? Probably 68 if we're not getting a big enough collection? Right? But the image is always 98.6. What's 98.6? The temperature of a human body. Isn't that incredible? On the day that Mexico legalized abortion, now this is in your lifetime, probably. Mostly anyway, 2007, November of 2007, they had a vote in Mexico to legalize abortion. At the moment that it was approved, light emanated from the womb of the image of Guadalupe in the shape of a fetus. We talked about this. This little cross brooch at her neck was the cross of Columbus, So when the Spanish were there, they had that same cross on their ships and on their helmets. So they knew, this is okay, these people are good. We need to work together. When you see a painting, most of the time when you walk closer to it, it sharpens up. You can see it better. When you're way far away, it's kind of blurry. Exact opposite. When you get close, you can't make out any of those details. But when you back up and you look at it, all of a sudden it sharpens. Scientists can't explain that. Can't explain it. The face of this virgin right here, this face, is all one shade. Now, if you were painting something and you'd got paint and a brush and you painted a big section all one shade, what would you see? Just the color, right? Why does it have she have eyes and nose and lips if it's all one shade of the one color? Because when NASA tested it, they found that the colors were hovering in midair, 1/300th of an inch, which is about the width of your hair, above the material. And it was picking up the imperfections of the ayate below to cause the facial features. So right where you see her lip, that's really a knot that was in the ayate, where it had been started to come undone, and they took it and they tied a little knot to keep it from unraveling. That ended up forming the lips. I'm sure it's just all accidental that all these things were in the right position to create her image, right? You think? Accidental? I don't think so. All of the best artists in the world have come to visit and to look at this, and they said there's no way anybody could have painted that. No artist could create it. It's just too well done and too perfect. They have never been able to exactly duplicate the image of Our Lady Guadalupe. They take digital pictures, they take videos, they take everything. They can't duplicate it. It's impossible. They don't understand why. The color actually changes when you start viewing it from different angles. That's why you see somebody saying it's blue and other people say it's green, other people say it's turquoise. Teal, it kind of changes as you're looking at it. In 1936, the University of Heidelberg, which was the foremost authority on chemistry in the world, took a sample and determined that the colors themselves, the particular shades, could not possibly have been developed from anything on the face of the earth. No animal, vegetable, or mineral could create those colors. We can do it with synthetics today, but they weren't developed until 300 years afterwards. No brushstrokes. The stars. We discovered in the 20s that the stars are actually in the same order as the constellation around Mexico City on the night of the apparition. So in 1531, if you looked at the sky, this is what you would see in the southern sky, these constellations. And they all match identically with Our Lady's stars on her mantle. And in the northern constellations, we're all on the left side, all matching exactly. The ayate we talked about is probably 20, 25 years, almost 500 years, and it's remained unchanged. Unchanged. For a century, it was hung without any glass. Candles, smoke, incense. You know, Our Lady of Lourdes is only 1858. That's only 150 years, a little more than 150 years. And they've had to clean that cave several times already from all of the candles. Candles didn't bother this. Same toxins. They actually touched it millions of times, even though it's cactus fiber, and they weren't able to destroy it. In 29, they discovered a human face and found it to be the bust of Juan Diego. They actually, using an ophthalmologist, examined it and found that the image itself acted like an eye. The doctor even talked to it by mistake. He said, ooh, could you move to the left? And then he laughed at himself. So miracles. The image itself is a miracle. The Indian cured is a miracle. We talked about that. There was a nationwide plague of typhus following a severe, severe drought. And it was, you know, and they used to, in their old culture, just kill more people, sacrifice more people to the gods to get rid of it. Well, now they didn't. They actually had a pilgrimage of children that went and prayed. And almost instantly after they did that, the plague stopped. In the Battle of Lepanto, we talk about in 1571, when the Muslims were twice the number of boats in the Mediterranean Sea against the Christians. And the Pope asked everybody to say the rosary. We won that battle. The winds made them very confused, and our troops were able to go and win that battle, Christianity. On the flagship was the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe. In 1629, there was a flood, and Sister Petronia had a vision of Our Lady holding up a wall of water, and she said, "Dear Mother, why would the Lord allow so many people to die?" And she said, "Many more would die for the injustice and for the desecration in mind of the Eucharist if it wasn't for me to intercede for you." In 1791, workmen were cleaning the frame and they spilled nitric acid. You see this over here? This was all acid that fell on the ayate, which again is just fibers from a cactus, and it did no damage at all. This is a cross that was in the basilica, and you can kind of see the people standing there. It's a big cross. It stands about this tall, and it's very, very heavy brass. And it was in the basilica during the 1920s when the Cristero Wars were going on, right? When Calles in Mexico wanted to eliminate Christianity. He wanted to close the church. And all the churches were closed except the basilica. And he knew that if he destroyed the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe, the Catholic Church would be done. And he would finally have his way. So they had somebody plant a bomb and some flowers, and they brought it to the Mass at 10 o'clock in the morning. And the bishop is saying the Mass, and it exploded. A football field away, glass was shattered. All the windows in the chapel were broken. Marble was torn off the altar and the walls. Miraculously, nobody was hurt. And this was right underneath the image of Our Lady. And the glass didn't even crack. Our Lord, who was there, took the force of the explosion upon himself and it bent that cross like that. He took that sin upon himself as he took your sins and my sins upon himself for our salvation. It's very beautiful. I hope someday you get a chance to see it. When they have the traveling image, they actually bring that image around. And while they were bringing that image from town to town, it's not the original, but it was as close a copy as they can get. It's called the traveling image of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And while they had it in one town, a little girl comes to her mother and says, "Mommy, did you hear it? Did you hear it?" "Did you hear what, honey?" "The heartbeat. There was a heartbeat." "Oh, honey, I don't think so. That's just a painting." "No, no, Mommy, it was a heartbeat." So they tell, somebody hears it. They get a doctor who comes up with a stethoscope, puts it on the image. And he says, "It's not a heartbeat. It's two heartbeats. It's the heartbeat of the mother and a heartbeat of 140 beats per minute of the child in her womb." That image was brought into many places. At one time, it was brought into a hospital to a little girl that was suffering from leukemia, and she was cured instantly. Again, there's many, 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 many more things about this image and about this history that are there for us to understand, to learn about, to deepen our own faith and our trust, because that's what she wants us to do. Trust in me, trust in my son, because I will bring you to my son. Everything I do will lead you to my son. And that's her message. Her message is different in Our Lady of Guadalupe than any of her other apparitions. It's more about how she loves us and is protecting us and is going to bring us to her son. And hopefully, in leading the third evangelization, she will count on you and 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 me to help, to spread the word, to not be afraid to talk about these incredible things. Because, you know, you don't have, sometimes you say something and somebody will look it up and they'll find something and say, you're just full of it, you're just full. Not here. They can go and look it up. It's all right there in black and white. Everything I've heard, told you, except for the John Paul II thing, which I think will come to light sooner or later. But everything else is documented. And it's not documented by priests and the church. It's documented by the civil authorities of the time. It's incredible. Strengthen your faith. Continue in your faith. Don't let your age, as you grow older, come between you and the wonderful gifts that God's given you through the Catholic Church, because we all want to be together one day in heaven with Our Lady of Guadalupe. Thanks very much.